call your attention to, I meant to bring mine up here with me, but if you did not grab one of the elements that is available to you for the Lord's Supper tonight, I invite you to go grab one if you need to. Back in the back or in front, you can raise your hand. John Wayne will be happy to bring it to you at any time. So go ahead and have that in your hands if you will. The book of 1 John, chapter 4, beginning in verse 7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for loving us. Lord, we thank you for showing us through your Son, Jesus Christ, how to love. And Father, I pray tonight that as a result of encountering you in worship, that when we leave here this evening, Lord, we will be better equipped to love one another as you have loved us. Lord, I thank you for your church, and I thank you for her gathering tonight. And Lord, I pray that you would bless us as we seek to bless you in our worship of you tonight. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You need church to remember something of him. We worship him tonight.
Yeah. Thank you.
very much, Lisa. It's good to have you back. It's part of the music ministry. Glad you're here. Once again, if you did not pick one of these up, please do so. It's at the back or out front. You can do that. And just a quick word, our offering baskets are in the front and the back as well. If you came tonight wanting to give an offering, and you can certainly do that as well. Obviously, Sunday nights are a little different around Parkview now. Once a quarter or so, we gather back in the sanctuary like we are tonight so that we can worship collectively and corporately. And the other Sunday nights now we are spent in homes as well as in this room also across the parking lot with the students doing discipleship. And I love that. I love going to the different groups. Every time I go to one of the groups, I'm amazed and surprised and thrilled at what I see and hear in all of those. And so be looking for some more information coming in the days ahead. You know, every now and then you got to cast your vision and then recast it and recast it. All you have to do is read and look at the book of Nehemiah. You'll find that out. And so we're going to continue to try to drive more traffic into homes and gain more homes and get more discipleship groups going in the weeks and months ahead. Now, I want to do one more thing, one more time. I hate the fact that I have to do this, but I've answered a lot of confusing questions since this morning. And so I remind myself, my brother and I kind of tease each other at times like this, when we don't communicate well, and we remind each other, hey, we communicate for a living. And so every now and then, those who are communicators, they don't quite do it that well. So let me tell you one last time, I hope. I have some form of severe injury to my shoulder. Okay? And I have been given a very difficult sentence by my first doctor in how to repair it if it's even repairable in his mind. So, Lori and I did not accept that, and so we continued to look at surgery. Friends led us to a second opinion, which is in the long and short of this story, going to give me a little hope, I hope. Okay? Here's what the doctor said. He said, let's throw a Hail Mary at this. I said, okay. And I reminded myself then, keep your eye on this doctor while we talk, because I was always told that if you were in the midst of a storm on a boat, look at the face of the captain, look into his eyes, and listen to his voice, and that way you will know whether you need to be scared or not. And so as I looked in his face and I heard all of the things he had to say to me and Lori, he had enough confidence, he gave us enough hope, and he said, I have done worse, I've helped people with worse problems, and he said, if it doesn't work, at least we didn't burn any bridges, we'll go at it again somehow. I'm like, I'm in. Whatever will give me hope. So that's what's happening to me, and that's what we're being on Wednesday, April the 7th. And that's what I meant when I said, after that, you may not see my face as much, you may not hear my voice as much for a little while, and that's when I gave you that one good word. And that word is in the house tonight, Brother Herman Parker. He's going to spend a couple of Sundays with us, and we'll figure out some of the rest. And I'll be behind the scenes. Luckily, I don't have to work hard for a living, and so I'll be able to do all the things that I can do, but it may just take me just a little bit of time. So I hope that clears it up, and I don't have to address that again, because I don't want to keep talking about that. But hey, I want to introduce y'all to a new friend of mine. Javaris, would you come up here? Javaris? Yeah, you. You know who you are, Javaris? I think y'all might know Javaris, okay?
You gotta tell the joke.
Look, all I know is that I have a tape. I'm gonna stand up on this. No, you stand up there. I'm gonna step here so I can talk to her. This is my new text friend named Javaris. Y'all know Javaris? Y'all might know him as Jonathan Williams, okay? But he texted me one day, messing with me, and wanting to know about our church, and he said, my name's Javaris. I'm like, all right, Javaris, let's go. And so we just got to going, but hey, I know you have roots here in Eufaula, right? And y'all have roots with him. I have heard that we need to have you and Brad Stevens sing a duet. Is that true? Facebook and messenger. He's always very kind to me. He keeps up with everything that goes on here. And he is the minister of outreach at a 3,000 member church in Montgomery, Alabama.
Too much.
if you every day or every week at the end of the day or the end of the week go back and do an inventory of that time and you say, wow, I just didn't seem to get it all done. I had multiple projects that I wanted to get started. Some projects that I got started and I got halfway through. Some of the dreams of what I wanted to do just didn't seem to materialize. And unfinished business abounds. I've been told, well, then you're trying to do too much. This is obviously a problem that Jesus did not have. Jesus finished all of his business. Now, if you have your Bibles open to John chapter 19, we're going to begin reading in verse 28. So it's going to be a little bit of a review of what we read this morning. But we're going to read through verse number 30, and this is what it reads. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now, Jesus' journey, Jesus' purpose in life, had begun approximately 33 years prior to this moment in a simple little stable. And at this moment, from that point till now, and we know Jesus' purpose began way before the beginning of time, but as a man, for these 33 years, at this moment, Jesus was able to declare these words because his task was done. It was completed. I think of the disciples that had left to go get food for Jesus in John chapter 4 while he was there visiting with a Samaritan woman at the well. And when they came back, they saw an energy in him that made them think, well, where did he get food? Where did he get nourishment? To which Jesus said, my food is to do the will of the Father who sent me and to finish his work. I love the word tenacity. I love a tenacious individual. That is a person who is resolute. That is a person who is focused. That is a person who does not let other things get in their way once they know exactly what their purpose is and what their goal is, and they work toward it. It happens to be one of the traits of my daughter. I've always looked at my daughter, and I've known that she's a very tenacious individual, and once she is on that path, she is unmoved. And if you know what I'm talking about, or if you don't know what I'm talking about, ask Lori, she can tell you. Tenacious. And that's the way Jesus was. He was a man of purpose. Fully man, as we talked about, and he said, I have come to do the work of my Father who sent me and to finish his work. What actually was finished at this point? When Jesus says, it is finished, what was the mission that was now finished as he uttered these words? Let me give you a couple of examples. In Luke chapter 19, in verse number 10, Jesus says, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. He had completed his task. In Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, Jesus gives us multiple versions of the same purpose that was his. Number one, he says, I have come to preach the good news to the poor. He said, I have come to proclaim freedom for the prisoners. He said, my purpose is to come and give recovery of sight to the blind and to release the oppressed and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. In John chapter 10, verse 10, he gives us more of his purpose that was finished when he tells us that the thief came to steal, kill, and destroy. But I, he says, have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Upon his arrest in John chapter 18 and verse 37 to Pilate, he simply said, I have come to testify to the truth. In John chapter 1 and verse 29, John the Baptist spoke of the purpose of Jesus that he came to fulfill, where he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus again spoke of himself in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, where he said, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Paul to the young Timothy, in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15, Paul says to him, he says, "Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners." John in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 5 says to us that he appeared to take away our sins. In a nutshell, you have heard in those random survey of verses the purpose of our Lord Jesus Christ that he had come to do. Now, Jesus often spoke of the work he had to do in the two metaphors of the cup and the baptism that were his to drink of fully and to be fully immersed in baptism as the will of the Father. And at this moment, Jesus knew that he had that the cup had been drunk and that the baptism was now complete. And so he declared again, "It is finished." I want you to look at those verses once again, because there's one singular idea found in these verses that's represented in three different words that are all derived from the same Greek root word, telos. Look at verse 28 where it says, "Later, knowing that all was now completed." There's your first word, completed. And it goes on and it says, "And so that the scripture would be," and here it is, "fulfilled." And then the third word comes in verse number 30, where again, after he finished the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." All three of these words, completed, fulfilled, and finished, all come from the same word, and it all again puts together this singular idea of completing an activity, completing the process, bringing it to closure, bringing it to an end. And in regards to time, it describes something that has come to an end. It is now over. And because of the tense of the verb here, it not only describes a past action that is complete, but the effect of this verb is that it will continue to be made complete. It has been done, Jesus says, and it still will be done. To telestai is the word. To telestai, it's used in many different ways. A servant to his master would come to him and declare, "To telestai." In other words, "I have fulfilled the task before me." The judge, when looking at a case or looking at an individual, would declare to telestai, saying to that individual and to those listening that justice has been served and the sentence has been completed. The accountant or the store merchant would declare to telestai when describing an account and a debt that had been paid in full. The artist would declare to telestai as he or she would put that final stroke of the brush on that painting, saying in essence the painting is now complete as they step back from the portrait. The priest would declare to telestai when saying that the offering has now been given. This is the word of our Lord, to telestai. It is finished. It is done. It is complete. I have stayed the course. I have fulfilled my purpose. It is done. Now here's the irony of Jesus speaking these words at that moment. And the irony is this. No one there, I believe, understood what he meant. No one present that day like we do today, no one understood what Jesus was saying. Let's take the Romans for example. They heard Jesus declare to Telestai, "It is finished," and they probably thought, "Well, you're right. We're done with yet another troublemaker." To Pilate, when he heard this word to Telestai, where Jesus declared, "It is finished," Pilate thought, "Well, yes, it is finished, and now hopefully my political headaches are gone." The Pharisees, for example. The Pharisees heard Jesus declare to Telestai, "It is finished." And I'm sure the Pharisees at that time said to themselves, "Yes, our competition has now been eliminated." To his disciples, who were not even there, but got the word that to Telestai, "It is finished." I'm sure at that moment they thought to themselves that our dream of a new kingdom has vanished. No one understood it that day. As Jesus declared, as the darkness began to lift, as he declared to Telestai, everyone scratched their head wondering, what is it that Jesus meant? We know today that this word to Telestai was not a cry of defeat. We know that this word to Telestai was not a cry of agony at all. It was not a cry of pain. It was not a cry of emotional distress. It was not a cry of any of those things. Jesus was not crying defeat. This was indeed a cry of victory. And so as Jesus on that cross declared to Telestai, he was declaring and claiming victory at that moment like it had never been claimed before. And that is our gift from him in this word, and that is our victory is found in him. Losers whimper away when they are defeated. Winners declare victory. Many years ago, I was about to say when he was young, but he's still young. My son, he was 25 years ago. I've forgotten exactly what was going on, but my son won. And he decided to declare victory. And so he did so by clenching his fists, and I'm going to try to do this, and he raised his arms above his head and looked to the sky and goes, "Ha ha ha!" To which my wife, with me in the room, and my father was here this morning, she looked at me and said, "There is still not a humble Fortenberry man alive." I grew up in a sports family. My father and his two brothers, all three of them, in different ways of what have you, were all professional athletes when they were young. That gene didn't get passed to me. It kind of skipped a generation. I'm still kind of a little bitter about that, whatever. But anyway, the winners declare victory. And Jesus that day said, "It is finished." The journey that began in a simple stable, that culminated in that moment in untold agony on the cross, resulted in sin, death, hell, and the grave being fully defeated and forever crushed by our Savior. All the things that God had promised for hundreds of years had been fulfilled. All the demands of God's justice fully satisfied. All the debt that was owed by my sin was paid in full. All the fear of death, are you with me? All the fear of death was wiped away. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 and 15 says this, "Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity,
so that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. He has forever defeated your fear, my fear of death. He also forever defeated the power of Satan. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, it says this, "And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross." Your gift tonight is the gift of victory. To tell us that it is finished. I want you to pray. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed for a moment, I want to slowly, so that you can pray, call out to you these six gifts from our Lord. As we seek to prepare our heart and our mind partake of the Lord's Supper, what better way would there be to worship him now but to consider these gifts that he's given and pray and give him thanks. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Forgiveness. Assuredly, I say unto you, today you will be with me in paradise. Assurance. The affection and the love of our Lord shown to us as he showed his mother, saying, "Behold your son," and to John, "Behold your mother." His anguish is a precious gift to you tonight, where he declared with the greatest of emotion that a person has ever declared a word on planet Earth, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" So that you would not have to live in anguish today or for eternity. His humanity, another precious gift to you. For you to know that he understands absolutely everything about your life, where he simply said, "I am thirsty." And ultimately tonight, the gift of victory, where triumphantly, not arrogantly, but triumphantly, he declared, "It is finished." He completed everything for you. Father, you are indeed worthy of all of our worship. Father, you are indeed worthy of our lives. Lord, there's no way we can repay you for what you've done for us. Your kindness is unfathomable. Your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your love. Unsearchable. Lord, how can we really know these things? Lord, it's beyond our human ability to fully grasp your heart tonight. So Lord, we simply say, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for filling me with assurance. Thank you, Lord, for demonstrating affection and love towards me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the anguish that you went through so that I would not. Thank you for being that substitute for me. Lord, I thank you tonight for your humanity. Being fully God, yet fully human at the same time. Able to understand, sympathize, and suffer along with me in everything that life has done. Lord, I thank you tonight for victory. I thank you, Father, for the fact that we've won. That in you, Lord, we have victory. And Lord, we know and we confess right now that this victory has nothing to do with ourselves. You have done it all. You accomplished absolutely everything. And again, Father, that makes you praiseworthy tonight. We love you. And Lord, as we come now to be obedient to your command to remember all that you've done in your broken body and in your shed blood, Lord, I pray tonight that as we partake of these elements to demonstrate our participation in your sufferings through your body and blood, Lord, I pray that we'll reflect on these six gifts tonight, knowing that you're worthy again of all of our worship. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You have in front of you your elements. And there's two different sides to it. And you can begin. And you can open up the side that has your wafer in it. That's where we'll begin. Before we do, I'm going to read to you the words out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 as Paul speaks to this time for us tonight, where he says this, beginning in verse number 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. He says, do this in remembrance. Brother Herman, can I ask you, please, sir, would you pray tonight and just give thanks for the broken body of our Lord tonight?
Father, we stand in awe of your great mercy, your great grace, your great love, the great sacrifice you made for us. As we visited our pastor to preach over this feast, our hearts were crushed again. We think about the sacrifice you made. And oh, what an awesome price you paid, dear God, for us. Pouring out your blood, your body being broken for us, suffering in a way that no words can describe, no mind can comprehend, no artist can paint, no poet can put into words the suffering that you gave for us, you experienced for us. And I just want to say thank you, oh God, thank you. Thank you for your broken body. Thank you for the pain that you endured for me. That is for my sins, for my iniquities, for my transgressions, for my disobedience. Every sin that I have ever committed or ever will commit, God, you took care of my suffering, Lord. You paid my debt in full. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. It is finished. that has been paid. We give you praise and glory for it. May we not just eat the bread casually, but may we do it reverently. Remember in the broken body of our new Savior. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Isaiah 53, we read these words, surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we consider him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And who could speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. Yet, it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. He said, take and eat. This is my body, which has been broken for you. You can do the same with your cup as you prepare. Paul continues in 1 Corinthians 11, where he says, in the same way after supper he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. I'm going to ask John Wayne, would you mind offering a prayer just to simply say, thank you, Lord, for your shed blood to cover my sin.
Lord, we love you. Father, we're humbled by the opportunity you gave us to remember you in this way, Father. We thank you for your blood, Father. The word said without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin, Father. That was in the sacrificial time, Father, that your Son final sacrifice, shed blood to wash away our sins and make us white still, Father. We're so thankful for the blood that ran down that cross, that puddled up at the bottom, that we can claim forgiveness because you covered our sin. Father, we're guilty. It's because of us that the blood was shed. Thank you so much for your forgiveness. We love you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.
To quote what John Wayne just said in his prayer, Hebrews 9:22, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Aren't you grateful for the shed blood of Jesus? Again, Jesus said, drink, this is my blood, in remembrance of me. Paul goes on to say that whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. I got one more question for you tonight in light of what we know. What should you do? What should we do? If we want to live a life in a worthy manner, by examining ourselves and proclaiming his death until we come, what should we do? With him as our example, let me just give you a brief thought. Number one, I would say to you today, live a life of purpose. Your gifts, your talents, your passions, your time, Jesus was focused on his purpose, and nothing got him off track. Live a life of purpose. Live a life of focus. Live a life of disciplined priorities. I was always told years ago that a disciplined life is a successful life. Live a life of purpose and live a life of focus. And then finally, I would say to you, live a life of obedience. If our Lord Jesus Christ can humble himself as God of all creation and become obedient to death, even death on the cross, according to Paul, then surely I can live a life of obedience to his word. Are you willing to live this kind of life? A life of purpose, a life of focus, a life of obedience. Isn't God good? Aren't his gifts wonderful? To be forgiven, to be given assurance, to be shown affection and love, to be have his humanity revealed to us, to know that he paid an enormous price as the substitute where I should have been, so that we can be victorious. And I cannot wait till next week. I want Sunday to get here immediately, where we talk about these words. Father, into your hands I entrust my spirit. And I want to ask you to do something for me. I want to ask you to help me create a nightmare for Stephen Parker. I want you to invite so many people next week that he scratches his head and doesn't know what to do. I want it to be such a dilemma that he skips right over me and goes straight to God and says, God, what do I do about this? Would you help me in that? Let's pray, and then Luis is going to close us out in the end. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for your love for us. I thank you, Lord, that we can even smile tonight and even laugh a little. But Lord, more than anything, I thank you for just what the cross meant to us. And I'm thankful tonight, Lord, that ultimately, as we've looked at all these gifts, that we can claim victory because of all that you have done. We praise you. We love you. We honor you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.